I'm Allison Singer from the Autism Science Foundation, here today with Dr. Josh Diehl. Josh is the William J. Shaw Assistant Professor of Psychology at Notre Dame University, and he is an expert in applying technology in autism treatments. And it looks like you brought some technology with you. So thank you for joining us today.
Thank you for inviting me.
And please introduce your guest.
Well, this is Kelly. She's a now robot from Aldebaran Robotics. She was originally designed to play robotic soccer in the robotics cup. But one of the things that we're really interested in is there's a lot of flexibility for her in terms of being able to do social interactions in the sense that she can gesture, she can produce speech. And so we saw a lot of potential for her in terms of maybe an opportunity to teach social skills. As you can see, she has fingers that can move and her arms can move in terms of gestures and has some human characteristics, but not so much as they're going to be distracting. We're really trying to simplify some of the interactions.
So how specifically would Kelly work with a child with autism? Mm-hmm.
So it depends on the child's level of communication. Some of the basic ways that we're using Kelly are for things like learning how to ask questions for the more verbal children, asking questions appropriately, responding to questions and responding appropriately, making social comments. So for a child that's verbal, one of the things that we do is we'll have the child practice the skill with their therapist, and when they practice the skill for a while, they then get to practice it with Kelly as if Kelly were a peer. And the therapist is there coaching the child while the child is practicing with Kelly. So it's great because it provides a safe and motivating environment for the child to practice the skills in a way that can be fun, but also in a way that they can be actively coached by their therapist.
And does Kelly work with children one-to-one or in a classroom environment? How does it work?
In our original research study, we used her in a therapy environment, working with a human therapist and with her as the co-therapist. We're currently piloting Kelly in a number of different settings. She's working in a center for a center-based school for individuals with autism, and she's working similar to what we're doing, but not with researchers. There are actual therapists that are using her in that setting. She's also being used in music therapy classes now. We have a partner, Madonna School in Omaha, Nebraska, that's been using her in more group type settings. Now, in terms of the potential for her, we originally envisioned her to be used in one-on-one therapy, but really it's two-on-one because she's more of a co-therapist than replacing the human therapist. You'd never want to do that. For some of our older kids, they were really more interested in how she worked than having a conversation with her. So one of the things that we developed this summer was a different role for her. It was a summer science camp, so to speak, where individuals from the community, both with and without autism, who had an interest in robotics, came in and they learned how to program her. But as part of that, they were working in groups. We were teaching everybody career skills. Now you can call them social skills, you can call them vocational skills, whatever you want to call them. We were working on a lot of the same things that they would have been working on in social skills therapy, but it wasn't therapy. It was part of learning a vocation, learning a trade. So it was a really motivating opportunity for them to learn the skills in a very safe and supervised environment.
What does the science show us about this type of interaction, the use of robots as co-therapists?
Well, I can tell you that a lot of the things that we've seen have been promising and in some ways really surprising to me. I went into this very, very skeptical. There was a lot of publicity about using robots with individuals with autism, and I understood the theory. The theory was that there was something about the interactions that might simplify and allow you to focus on certain skills rather than having, you can control whether the robot's gesturing or whether they're making facial expressions, so you can really isolate the things that you're focusing on. So that showed promise to me, but I was always skeptical because I thought that we didn't want children to interact with robots. We wanted children to interact with humans. So in our research studies, we never measured whether their improvement in terms of their interaction with the robot. When we were looking at their improvement, we were having them practice with the robot, and then we were looking at how they did with their human therapist after interacting with the robot. We were looking at how they did with their parents after they left the therapy setting. And that was the thing that was really surprising to me, as we saw just learning these basic skills in a fun, motivating environment, that they were transferring naturally, which really doesn't always happen. The one thing I will say is that there are individual differences. So you can't expect one therapy to work for all children. And we saw a number of children who really, really responded to this approach. And there were other children, the ones that really were doing better with their human therapist, in some ways this could be a distraction. It could lead to an increase in repetitive behavior. So you can't just assume that it's going to work for all children. And I think one of the next steps that we need to do is figure out how can we predict which children are going to be most likely to respond to this approach so we can target those children or groups of children.
So in the children who did respond, what types of improvements did you see?
Right. So we were doing applied behavior analysis type therapy. So we were targeting specific skills and measuring those skills in terms of over time. We did a pretest where we looked to see if they were showing improvement without the robot there. Then we had them interact with somebody who is a human co-therapist, and then we would replace that human co-therapist with the robot. And where we saw the improvements, especially in our verbal children, they were our target skills again were learning how to do greetings. When you start carrying on a conversation, how do you stay on the topic as opposed to going more towards whatever your own special interest is. And because we had sort of an MO for Kelly, in the sense that she had a backstory, she had a history that you could learn about, just like anybody has an interesting story. And the fact that you have a robot that has an interesting backstory is pretty motivating. And we thought that that provided motivation, but it also was really good at getting the children to learn how to stay on topic, how to ask follow-up questions, because they were motivated to do it. It was a really exciting opportunity, but a real opportunity for them to practice those skills.
So Kelly looks pretty expensive. Is mm-hmm. this a realistic, cost-effective opportunity in the main, for the mainstream?
Right, that's a fantastic question. And when we went into this project, we weren't looking to market the robot. That wasn't our goal. I'm a clinical psychologist. I'm not a roboticist. And I was really interested in the clinical applications. And when we went into it, we weren't going to buy the cheapest robot we were going to find, because if we bought a cheap robot and the approach didn't work, well, maybe it was because of the cheap robot. So we, at the time, went for the best technology that we thought was out there, in some ways to anticipate technological breakthroughs. What we were finding is with a very, very expensive robot. And so I don't think it right now is at the point where I would recommend going out and buying an $18,000 robot. But as with any technology, if we find that it's working and you're able to, you know, increase scale, the prices are going to eventually come down. So we didn't want to wait for the prices to come down. We wanted to see, in an ideal scenario, is this going to be of benefit to the families?
So sometimes technologies and interventions that work in a lab environment don't always translate so well when we get into a real classroom. What do you expect to see from Kelly in a real classroom with real children?
Well, that's one of the most important questions that we're pursuing in research right now. The gains that we've seen to date have been in a controlled, careful research setting with really carefully trained therapists who are being coached. So our next step has been to transfer it to centers in the community. We have a center-based program for individuals with autism in Erie, Pennsylvania, that's using it in the same method and the same strategy that we're using in terms of one-on-one therapy with a human, but the robot is the co-therapist. We also have a second center in Omaha, Nebraska, that's using it in more of a classroom type setting, in like a music therapy type setting, in like a speech therapy type setting, when they're working in groups, to see if these gains are transferable not only to these research settings, but in a broader setting with multiple children using that approach.
And do you see differences in effectiveness in one-to-one versus a larger classroom, or is it working in both?
We don't have, a lot of that started this fall, so we don't have the data to say that there's a better approach to use, for which we can use Kelly in those sorts of settings. But we're hoping to have that sort of information.
Well, we're really looking forward to seeing more data and learning mm-hmm. more about how to use this type of technology to help more children. So thank you so much for joining us today.
All right, thank you.